All righty. So in July 1961, a coach by the name of Vince Lombardi walked to the front of a large meeting room. Flanked around him were 38 Green Bay Packer football players, and they were all sitting on the edge of their seat waiting to hear what the venerable coach might have to say. Now, if you know your football history, you might remember that the year before 1960, they had, through a lot of sweat and a lot of effort, you know, kind of made the playoffs only to be defeated in the final few minutes of the game by their arch nemesis, the Philadelphia Eagles. And I hope I'm not triggering anybody in the room, okay? And so while they were there, and some would write, still in the agony of defeat, and they were licking their wounds over the 1960 season, Coach Lombardi was already eyeing season 1961. He walked to the front of the room, and he carried a football under his arm. And he took a moment to look the players in the eyes and sort of, you know, kind of massage all of the drama that was dripping off the four corners of the room. And then Coach Lombardi took the ball out from under his arm, looked the players in the eyes, and said the now immortal words, the immortal sentence. Some of you know it. "Gentlemen," he said, "this is a football." And with that sentence, a new day in the team's history began. He would take the entire team. Some of the people who were flirting already with Hall of Fame status, people like Bart Starr, remember him? Ray Horning, or Paul Horning, Ray Nietzsche. And he would do with those players and with the rest of the team what hadn't been done in a long time. He would take the preseason of 1961 and he would focus on the fundamentals of the game. And if you know, again, your football history, here's what history would tell you. They did maneuver through the 1961 season. They ended up in the playoffs again, and they soundly defeated the New York Giants. Again, if I'm triggering anybody, I apologize. And but here's a little footnote to football history. Because he did that, Coach Lombardi never again lost a playoff game in his entire career. Not a single one. And that story is, in a way, emblematic of what I'm going to invite our church family into over these next 6 weekends. And what we're going to do is we're going to take all of the seasoned vets that are in the room and maybe the rookies that are in the room. And I'm going to invite onto the stage over these next 6 weeks a conversation that many of us on the pastoral side of our church staff have many times throughout the week in small meeting rooms or in coffee shops or in offices. And with that, and while I'm going to protect all the anonymity of those conversations, I want to tell you how they'll often go. We'll meet together. We'll get a coffee. We'll sit down, and after a few moments of initial conversation, you know, and small talk, we'll take a few sips of coffee, and then we'll sort of maybe focus for a few moments even and have some discussion on what I would call the presenting issue. Before the conversation is over, before the meeting's over, it's not uncommon for me to entertain questions like this. "Hey, it's all true, right? What's true?" "Like, this is true." "Yeah, it's true. I mean, God is real, right?" "Yep, God is real. God has a desire in a particular way that I should live my life." "Yep, he actually does. Does he care about me?" "Yes, he cares about me." I'm always tempted in those moments when people, some of you guys ask me those questions, to say, "Hey, look, if it's not true, I've wasted a lot of my time and a lot of other people's money." And when I was younger in my ministry as a pastor, to be very candid, these are the conversations that would give me some anxiety, and I want to tell you why. Because I believed 150% in what I would say and what I would offer in conversations like that, but I was often getting my pastoral legs up underneath me. And so I had some anxiety about that because I didn't want to mess anything up. Quick story. When I was in seminary the very first time, one of the classes that was required was a class called Greek exegesis. And let me tell you actually what it was. It presented as though it were just a grammatical course in understanding Greek grammar. But underneath that conversation or underneath that class was really the opportunity to get closer to the actual meaning of scriptural texts, which was very important. And the class was taught by a very diminutive Asian professor. He was from China, and he was very intimidating. And in fact, he carried a little baton with him. I'm not making any of this up. And when he said something really serious, he would hit his lectern with the baton. And he told a story one time. I was sitting near the front of the class. In my mind's eye, I can remember exactly where I was. The window was open. It was fall. The leaves were falling off the trees, and we could hear the breeze. And he started to tell this story of being in his homeland. And he said he was in his homeland, and he had gone one night to a church service, and he was listening to two Americans through a translator preach to the Chinese people in front of them. And then after they were through preaching, he said, they opened the altar, and he said a young man came down to the altar, and he was struggling with a sin problem. Anybody have a sin problem? And he was struggling with a sin problem, and he said, and the American through the translator, which Dr. Wong, my professor, could overhear, was explaining to him God's forgiveness. And he was explaining it wrong. And Dr. Wong said, this young man came to the altar seeking to be unburdened and set free. But because of the error in the teaching, he left the altar with the burden still on his shoulders. And I'll never forget this. And he took that baton and he hit the lectern with it. And he said, you better make sure you know what you're preaching, because eternity hangs in the balance. I've never forgotten that story. I feel it right now. And so what I want to do, and what we want to do as a teaching team over the next 6 weeks, is we just want to invite you into a conversation about why we're here. Not why we're here specifically, but maybe in a way, but why we're here. Like, why are we on this earth? Why does it matter? What does God have to say about all of these many different things? And so, like I said, what I want to do is I want, first of all, to have some conversation for those of us who in the room or online might self-identify as seasoned vets. And let me just say, if you self-identify as a seasoned vet, you are immediately disqualified from being a seasoned vet. Come on. I worked hard on that. All right. And here's what I want to say. If you would maybe self-identify as a seasoned vet, would you give me the space over these next 6 weeks to slow the RPMs down, to talk about a few things maybe you've heard before, or maybe you're even operating in, to allow us the opportunity maybe to on-ramp some other people? Will you give me the space to do that? Yes, okay, great, all right. One of my favorite verses in Scripture is a verse around this kind of topic. It comes from the second to the last book of the Bible, in the book of Jude. And in Jude 1:22, it simply says this. It says, "Be merciful to those who doubt." And so really what I want to just say in the room is here, let's practice what Jude writes. Let's be merciful to those who are trying to figure out the Christian experience and they're trying to put some stuff together. And in a way, all of these conversations, I think, we probably have a tendency to have more of these conversations than the average church because we have a very particular mission statement. And, you know, it's really posted everywhere. I'll show it to you again. And let's read this out loud together. Ready? Go. Community of Hope exists to interest disinterested people in Jesus Christ and grow together into fully devoted followers of him. So we might have a little bit more of these conversations because our church really believes we exist for this very purpose. Slow the RPMs down, onboard more people around the questions that really matter. When I was that younger in my faith, before we moved over to Palm Beach County and we were in Braden, and every now and again I will tell this story about, you know, I was growing up, I was 14, 15, 16, we were in this church, and sort of the unspoken rule of the church was don't rock the boat, don't ask a question, don't express any doubt, just act like you got it all figured out. And when I was 15 and a little rebellious and a little undisciplined, that didn't work for me. And the grand irony of things, when God eventually called a surfer boy into the ministry and then to plant a church with his beautiful wife. Amen. You know, we made a vow that we would always be a church where questions were okay. So that's what I want to do. If you self-identify as a seasoned vet, we're going to slow the RPMs down. We're going to on-ramp some people. Let's just do that. Now, if you self-identify as a rookie, that pre-qualifies you to be a seasoned vet. See how this works? Here's what I would tell you if you're a rookie. Come hungry. We have a value on our staff. We say it this way, be hot, which stands for hungry, open, and teachable. Come with the expectation. Here's what I would tell you. Come with just an open mind and open heart that God, by the power of his Holy Spirit, is here. And he wants to say some things to us. That's really all that's required in this space. Frankly, that's required of rookies and seasoned vets. Because are there any seasoned vets? No. Okay, so that's what we're going to do. Does that sound like a cool idea? Amen. Okay, all right. A golf clap and a dog. Awesome. Okay, great. Okay, all right. I want to invite you to stand, and I want to show you a scripture. So go ahead and stand. This is, and we're going to read this out loud together. Okay, ready? Go. A life devoted to things is a dead life, a stump. A God-shaped life is a flourishing tree. Let's read that again. A life devoted to things is a dead life, a stump, but a God-shaped life is a flourishing tree. Let's pray. Lord, we're going to manifest in this space a spirit of openness. And we are really aiming at maybe some of the deeper existential questions that are always running in our minds and hearts. We live at a particular moment in history, Lord, where you know, it's just popular sport to run at life in such a way as that we're multitasking and doing things, so many things all of the time. But God, when it gets quiet, sometimes at the end of the day, and sometimes when we're alone, we have these deeper questions. And so God, I'm gonna pray that you might use the space over the next 6 weeks to help us. For we pray this together in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. You may be seated. Hey, let me share with you, over the years when I've done this sort of thing, which again, we tend to do every now and again, I have pointed toward different resources that have been important. And I learned that because, you know, after the service, I tend to greet people in the lobby. And a lot of times, almost every Sunday, somebody asks me, hey, that quote, where'd you get that? What are you reading? This sort of thing. And we tend to be a church that kind of aims at that sort of thing. And so I learned a long time ago, sometimes what's a good idea is to point towards some resources. Many, many years ago, I think it was around 2000 or before, Rick Warren wrote a book entitled A Purpose-Driven Life. You may have heard of it. It's been rebranded, and I want to show it to you. It's called What on Earth Am I Here For? And so some of what he mentions in the book, we want to talk about. So I want to obviously give source credit for that. But here's what I love about this new resource is there's an opportunity for you to follow along. And so I'm going to do something that we rarely do in church. I'm going to invite you to get your phone out. Get your phone out right now. And then you could go tell everybody that, man, in our church, our pastor said, get your phone out rather than put your phone away. And I'm going to actually, we're going to show a QR code. And you can capture the QR code on your phone. It'll take you right to where you can order the book and follow along. And we want to commend this to you. Now, once you've done that, here's what I want to tell you. Put your phone away. Okay? So you had it, but now you put your phone away. And here's what I was thinking about that I want to talk about. When we read that verse, and Sheldon, put that verse that we just read, Proverbs 11:28, back up on the screen again. A life devoted to things is a dead life, but a God-shaped life is a flourishing tree. I want you to think about that for a moment. What this verse points at in so many ways is simply this grand idea, which is this. All of life starts with God. All of life starts with God. And really what I want to point to in a space like this, in a moment like this, is again, seasoned vets or rookies, what if we just floated this as an idea and we just said, okay, and I'm going to accept in faith, I'm going to start right here, that all of life begins and starts with God. Sometimes I'm brutally honest about my own church experience. And sometimes I share some of the harder stories. I'll share a good story. I grew up in a religious tradition where we would oftentimes on Sunday, we would say the Apostles' Creed. I don't know if you remember the Apostles' Creed. But it goes like this. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. And in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit. The Holy Catholic Church, which stands for universal. The communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. That's like the sum total of the gospel experience. But the Apostles' Creed starts with this. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. Here's the presupposition of that phrase. That there is a creator who has made the world. And part of the world is you, which means you have been created by God. All of life starts with God. Now, when we try to aim at an understanding that, here's what I think we have a tendency to do as human beings. We speculate as to what that means. Like we just make stuff up about it. Right? You ever talk to somebody? I remember Haley tells a fascinating story. She was a RA at a Christian university in Kentucky before they got married, and she was mentoring a younger student who was there, and she was far from home, and she was struggling and all of this, and she was asking all these existential questions. And then she started making this declarative sentence to Haley, and the sentence made no sense at all, if that's okay to say. So after she said all this stuff, Haley looked at her and she goes, "What does that mean that you what you just said?" And the girl goes, "I don't know what it means." And this is kind of sometimes what we do. We speculate about stuff. There was I'll share this story from Rick Warren's book. He said that there was a guy by the name of Dr. Hugh Moorhead, and he was trying to understand the reason why we live. Like, what's the reason of life? What is the meaning of life? And he reached out to all these philosophers and scientists and all of this, and he said, tell me what the meaning of life actually is. He interviewed 250 people. He wrote a book. I can show you a book. This is the book about it. And he said, according to the century's greatest writers and thinkers, he got all these different definitions of the meaning of life. And then they started reaching out to Hugh Moorhead offline, and they started saying things, actually, I don't really know the meaning of life. Actually, I made it all up. And then a few of them even went on and wrote him, and he got letters that said, if you discover the meaning of life, would you let me know? I'm still looking for it. Now, it's fascinating, right? Bertrand Russell, who is an atheist, said this, unless you assume a God, the reason for life is meaningless. Okay? So here's the thing. We can speculate about what life is all about, but the Bible gives us another way to do it. It's not speculation, it's called revelation. And revelation means that God will impart to you the meaning of life. He will reveal it to you. He will give it to you. Let me give you a secret. That's why at Community of Hope, whenever we read the passage of the Bible we're going to focus on, like we did a moment ago, I have you stand. Because let me tell you something that we learned in the last 3 or 4 years doing church. Before 2020, there was this impression of all of this unity around core ideas. And then the pandemic happened, and we realized we don't have any unity at all. And so I told our staff one afternoon, I said, I want to do slightly less preaching and slightly more teaching, because people need to learn. And I went on and I said, and we're going to focus more on teaching the scriptures, because the scriptures provide to us God's revelation about how life actually works. And it would be good for you to know. So when we come on a Sunday and we're standing and reading God's word, here's what I want you to understand we're doing in that moment. we're saying we want God's voice to be the loudest voice in the room. Not my voice. Okay, because I can get it wrong. If you're not sure, talk to Beth after church is over. She'll tell you, okay? And here's what I really want you to know. All joking aside, I might be up here preaching and teaching, but here's what I want you to know. I am sitting under the authority of God's word. I'm included among you. I'm more of a rookie and less a seasoned vet. When we built our church building in 2010, I buried one of my favorite Bibles right here. It's right here. Because I wanted to know that even when I'm standing here, I'm standing on the word of God. I just wanted that to be kind of a thing. And so here's what I want you to know. Here's our first risk. What if life isn't about you? Just what if it's not about you? What if it's not about your success, your legacy, your possessions, your whatever? What if it's about God? And what if it's about wherever you're living, whatever you're doing, we're all ambassadors in a way of this idea that all of life begins and ends with God. This is really our starting point. Remember, we're going to slow down and onboard some people. If we're going to move in that direction, I think there are three things you need to know, and I want to share them with you real quickly. One is simply this. To really get to this space, first of all, you have to accept these three things. Here they are. Number one, you are not an accident. You're not an accident. I know a friend of mine, kind of a delicate story of a friend of mine who really struggled with this idea because, to be candid, he didn't know who his dad was. And he was the product of a chance meetup. And he always felt, in a way, in his words, so don't judge me, illegitimate. And then he came to faith in Christ. He was learning about his Heavenly Father. There was a guy that was mentoring him. And that friend, that mentor, took this my friend's words, and he said, to use your word, he said, here's what I believe, and I love this. Kind of provocative, but I love it. He said, sometimes there are illegitimate parents, but there's never an illegitimate child. And when my friend heard that, he was able to step over the speed bump. The prophet Isaiah says it this way in Isaiah chapter 44, real quickly. He says, I am your creator. You were born, you were in my care even before you were born. Right? Pretty interesting. So if we're going to move in this way, first of all, I would just want to say you're not an accident. I found this quote by Michael Denton. He was a research fellow in New Zealand. And look at what he says. This is fascinating from a science perspective. All the evidence available in biological sciences supports the core proposition that the cosmos is a specially designed whole with life and humankind as its fundamental goal and purpose. We're wired. The universe is wired for us under God's design. And it's important to realize, I think, in this moment, that we are not an accident. Scripture says it this way, and some of us need to hear it. We are all fearfully and wonderfully made. Isn't that awesome? I have a friend who says, God don't make no junk. Cool. Amen. All right? Number two, you're made to live forever. Think about that for a moment. You're made to live forever. Ecclesiastes, Solomon writes this in Ecclesiastes chapter 3. He, being God, has made everything beautiful in its time. He has also set eternity in the human heart. Yet no one can fathom what God has done from beginning to end. That translation, set eternity in the human heart, means imparted eternity in our heart. Like God has taken eternity, put it in the heart of every human being. I love this quote. I think it was Abraham Lincoln said it this way. Surely God would not have created such a being as man to exist only for a day. No, man was made for eternity. Isn't that good? One of our favorite resources that we love to read, we read it to our kids when we were growing up, was the Chronicles of Narnia series. I don't know if you've ever read it. Everybody should read it. And at the end of the Chronicles of Narnia, C.S. Lewis writes this. Listen to how he says this. He says, for us now, this is the end of all stories. But for them, it was the beginning of the real story. For all their life in this world had only been the cover and title page. And now at last, they were beginning chapter one of the great story, which no one on earth has ever read, which goes on forever, and in which every chapter is better than the one before it. You're made for eternity. And so this is really important, what we're talking about. The psalmist said it this way in Psalm 39, verse 4. He said, Lord, show me my life's end and the number of my days. Let me know how fleeting my life is. We're only here on this earth for just a little while, but eternity will go on forever. So we have to live with that perspective. Okay, one other thing. This is important. This is kind of where we're driving to, of course. You were made for a reason. There's a reason why you are on this earth. And I think there's a scripture that I want to show here. Paul writes this. Notice this. Paul says, for everything, absolutely everything, above and below, visible and invisible, rank after rank after rank of angels, everything got started in God and finds its purpose in God. Amen, right? All right, for the next five weekends, we're gonna come in here hot, which is what? Humble, open, teachable. God, that's the disposition of our heart. We give it to you, and we pray that over this next season, you would reveal yourself to us in new and fresh ways. Lord, for the rookies, those of us getting our legs underneath us, and for the seasoned vets that need to learn too. We open our lives to you in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Go in his mercy. We'll see you next weekend.